This is a recording I thought I would complete as I was going along and demoing it to a couple of people. So I hope this recording is useful. This is in no way a complete recording. I'll probably create a better one later on. So this is almost an hour long. I'll go ahead and get started now. Okay, so in this video, we are going to go ahead and take a footage which looks like this and convert it into a footage like this. So I have a simple rock here in the background, and if I play through, you can see the camera is moving through it. Now, once we have processed through the entire footage, it's going to create something like this. So basically, we have a big hole in the rock, and our character is going to peep into it. So this is what we are going to create. I'm going to start from the creation of the 3D object and shading part of it, but I'm going to show you the preps which we have done in PF Track and other software. So let me shift over to PF Track. So here inside PF Track right now, we basically have this footage which we have taken in. It's entirely 279 frames in length. We have undistorted it so that the lens distortion is removed. We have applied shutter fix on this so that the sudden camera movement is taken care of. Then we have applied an auto track onto this. So we have gotten the entire camera solved using it, but just to get enough mesh around this rock itself, I've added another auto track which is going to give me enough detail on the sides. Once this is done, I've solved for the camera. So I have the entire camera solved created. So you can see this is the entire camera solved, but actually what I want is the entire 3D object created out of this. So I've used the image modeling node in PF Track to get create this 3D object. So basically what happens is once the track is done, all the 3D points are taken and connected together to create this entire output. So once I actually have this output directly, I can go ahead and export them. So what I've done is exported a Python script and also Maya files along with the OBJ object. So what it helps me do is take the compositing directly from Maya to Python, sorry, from Maya directly into Nuke without any problems. So once this is done, I'll switch over to Maya where I've imported the objects and get started by creating all the maps I require. So within Maya right now, I'll just go into the settings. Under settings, I'll change it to 25 frames per second and save it out. My frame range is actually from 1 to 279, so I'll set that in. Next, I'll go open up my file which I have actually. So I open my file. So once this has come in, if I switch over to my camera view, you can see this is the file I have. I have this 3D object which has come in. Now I have to go ahead and optimize this object a little bit and start editing it. I'll switch over to my outliner. I'll see where the object is. I'll duplicate it and get it out of my scene, and I'll hide my own scene. Now with the object itself, let me start by optimizing and removing the unwanted faces. I'll go switch over to the face mode. I'll get rid of all the faces which are really unnecessary for the output. Okay, so I have this file now. Let me remove a bit more. Okay, so I have this file now. I'm going to go ahead and create the deformations which I want onto this. So let me go ahead, select a couple of these vertices. Turn on soft select so it doesn't really create a very crisp output. Okay, so I have something which goes out like this. So the character is supposed to come in and actually look through this. So this is the shot, and because it's on the side, we can't really see what's happening. So let me go ahead and edit that. So I don't really care about how the mesh is being distorted much. I just want it to look good enough. Okay, so let's say for example I have it like this, so it looks like it's going through into the whole tunnel. So this is what I have. First, let me go ahead and unwrap this mesh. I'll just take this, I'll save out the scene. Okay, so now next thing is I'm going to start unwrapping this object. So to unwrap this, I'll directly go into my polygon menu. I'll go create UVs, planar mapping. I'll just apply a best plane mapping on top of this. So I have this map applied. Next step is I'm going to go ahead and edit this UVs directly. So in the UV texture editor, What I want to do is basically cut out the entire thing on the side so that I have a top half and a bottom half. So I'll go select these UVs on the sides. So know exactly where they fall here in the map. So these are the UVs I need. So now I'll just turn off my soft selection. I'll use the edge selection tool. I'll go select one corner edge over here and another corner edge over here. So it gives me this entire line selection. Whereas what I actually want is it to go from here to this point. So it's cutting through from there, and I wanted to take it through this point. So basically it's creating a top half and a bottom half of the whole texture. So I'll go shift right click, I'll go cut UVs. So that one cut is made. Next I'm going to go through the same point again. I'll go to UVs. Select. Okay, I'll just select the UV here and I'll go create another cut here at the bottom. Okay, it's not selecting the UVs on the same shell. Okay, so let me go ahead and cut these first. I'll go turn on polygon display and texture borders. It's kind of hard to see where exactly they are. Let me go ahead and actually lay out these first. Okay, so I cut out these three different maps. I'll lay out them first and I'm going to go unwrap them individually. So vertical and horizontal unwrap. Another time. Okay, so this one's done. I'll keep it on the side. Next. And next. So with these. Okay, so I have these scaled up. Let me go ahead and just redo this just a little bit on my own. Okay, so I just edited all of these UV islands. Now next step involved is going to be smoothing this entire mesh. So I'm just going to save this out once more and let's go smooth. I'm going to apply a linear smooth first. Now basically I'll keep it at exponential. I just keep it at zero continuity and apply one level of smooth and then increase the continuity with another level. So basically what I get is this. Okay, that looks a bit too harsh. Let me go re-edit that. Okay, one. Okay, that definitely does not look like rocks. So anyway, let me just give a normal smooth. Okay, so I have this. Next step is I want to add in a bit more detail than what actually comes in with this mesh. So I'll just select this, take my sculpt geometry tool, and in my tool settings I'll take a bitmap brush, and I'll just go into my brush. So in my brush images I just had to change it to all files here, just had to select all files. I'll just take something like the bricks texture, and with my push and pull, or basically pull, don't try to use a lot of push because it might actually give you unwanted inflections in the mesh. So I'm just adding in some amount of detail, not too much, just enough to break the surface a little bit. So one thing you will observe is that there are no inflections in this mesh, which you would probably have to get rid of. So the easiest way to get rid of these inflections is using the relax or smooth tool. So you can go ahead and start getting rid of these, which is going to be a bit of a headache, but still it's very useful. So anyway, I'm going to leave it as it is. I'm going to edit those in Nuke. So once I have this mesh, I want to go ahead and export this into Nuke. So I'll just save this once more. I'll take this object. I'll go enable OBJ export to begin with. So OBJ export is already loaded. So let me go export selection, and I'll go export this as my terrain 3. OBJ file. So that one is done. So now I have exported my object file, but right now I actually want to get in the shading on the object from Maya itself. So first let me go ahead and set up a simple lighting situation here. I'll go create a simple spotlight. I'll look through this. So this is supposed to be my let's say skylight lighting. I'll add in just some amount of linear decay. I don't really need it to be photorealistic as such. So increase that. So this is supposed to be the light coming in from the top, basically something like the sunlight. So this one is going to be this is supposed to be like the sunlight. So let me add in a bit of reddish tint into this. Or what I will actually do is I'll just give red color to this light. And next I'm going to create another spotlight, and this one I'm going to keep it directly in the front so the entire hole can be seen through. So this light I'm going to just give it a green. So I'm just giving red, green and blue colors so that I can actually go ahead and tweak the shading within Nuke. So this one is also going to have a linear decay, and I'm going to increase this because I really want the inside part of this cave to be dark. So that is done. Obviously if you have a HDR map of the scene that will be much better, but this is also going to work out. So once I have this, I'll also create one last light just in the opposite direction, just to give in a kicker. And this will obviously be blue, and let me give in a linear even on that and increase it. So basically I have RGB colors which are going to give me my lighting into the scene. The only thing is I want shadows from the light, so I'll just select the spotlight one. Under shadows, I'm just going to use ray trace shadows and a lot of blurring on the shadows and ray trace on that again. So just going to give me some kind of a good looking result. I'm going to save this once and re-render. So this is the result I have. I'm just going to switch into mental ray and re-render once more. Next main thing is I want to edit the material a little bit. So right now what I actually have is a simple fong which is actually reflective. So I'm going to remove the specular color on this material and remove the ambient color as such and re-render. So this is the actual lighting situation I have. So this is good enough. Only insides I really have a very dark environment, which I don't really care about because obviously it is going to be dark in my final scene too. So with this done, I can go ahead and bake all the lighting information which I actually have in the scene. So let me go ahead and make this material white, so I get the entire detail. I'll just keep the diffuse level low. Okay, so I'll just go into my red channel. So this is the green and blue. So this is good enough, but the white is a bit too much. I'll decrease that. So I'm getting some variation. So that is done. I'll go into my indirect lighting this time. Now, because it's a white object and the light is just bouncing around, Final Gather is going to give me the exact result which I need from those particular lights. So this Final Gather is going to be brighter, as you can see. So this is done. All I want to do is basically bake all this information onto the object itself. So just selecting the object, I'll go into rendering and lighting and shading, batch bake mental ray, and here I want to reset this. I want to bake the selected object. I want to bake it into texture and bake optimization for single objects, bake the shadows using the perspective view, or you can use the camera. Doesn't really matter because we're not using reflections or specular maps. And apart from that, let's see, I'll just override things. I'll just tell I want light and color, so choose that. I want the surface front right. Okay, I need a high resolution map, so let's say I take in 2048. So I'll go switch it to TIFF 16 bits. I'll also go into my render settings and quality and change it to frame buffer. Okay, so that is done. Number of samples, I'll increase that. Okay, so Final Gather quality is high. So fill texture seams, I'm going to increase this. So this is done. I'll just save it once more and I'll tell convert. So you can see here at the bottom that it's calculating the Final Gather and is going to start creating the actual output. So let me pause and get back to you. So this took about a minute to render this out. So if I just select this and go into my Lambert, you can see that there is an incandescence material being applied, and this is actual material which is being applied here. Let me just go ahead and view this. So as you can see, I've just opened this entire texture within Photoshop. I guess there is an overlap here. I'll have to go ahead and redo that, I guess, but I'll just use it as it is. So these kinds of things which I have here have to be clone stamped out, or you can use a patch tool within Photoshop. So just go ahead and get rid of these lines because it's going to really cause a lot of problem when you're trying to composite them in. So this is a very neat method of getting rid of these points, because Nuke really, the way I'm going to do it in Nuke, it's not going to really know whether or not the normals are flipped. So it's going to give the same results as long as someone doesn't really go ahead too deep into observing what's happening. So I go ahead, get rid of as many as possible which are the edges. So this kind of a thing is quite normal anytime triangulated mesh is highly subdivided and you're trying to sculpt on top of it. So I really recommend that if you really want to get an exact detail, go ahead, redo a quad mesh, take it into ZBrush, sculpt it in properly, add in all details you want, apply normal maps, diffuse maps, and then bake them so you have the exact output. Obviously, wherever I'm trying to edit this, it's going to change the lighting slightly, but it doesn't really matter much. Okay, so whatever I have done, let's say this is enough. Yeah, and just save this in. So next step is going to be actually going ahead and creating the texture itself. So to create the texture, I'll go open up one of the files. So here I basically have the undistorted files. I'll just go ahead and choose one of these images which has a lot of detail in it for my texture making. So I'll just open this up, and as you can see, there's a lot of detail in these files. I'll take my lasso and just go ahead and select a large part of this. Okay, I'll go ahead and crop this. And with my clone stamp now, I'll just try and add in a bit more extra details which don't exist. So always use clone stamp from different locations so you can't really see any pattern. So once this is done, I'll go ahead filter other offset. I'm going to offset this entirely so I can see exactly how the seam is being created. And now this time I can go ahead and get rid of the seam. Okay, so now most of the seam is gone. I'll just select the whole thing, and basically I can just export it and use it as a repeatable texture somewhere, but I really want to enhance a bit of these details which exist in this. I'll duplicate this layer. I'll add in a high pass on top of it. So let's say a very large high pass, and I'll levelize it so I get all these additional details. I'll go add it on overlay and keep it at a low opacity, so it's just adding slightly on top of the file itself. Next, again I'll duplicate it and apply the same effect, but this time to a very low degree, so a very low high pass, so let's say around only 2 pixels, so I get a lot of these details. I'll go add it on hard light again, and I'll keep it at a very low opacity. So now this is the file I had in the beginning, and this is the file I have now. So it just adds in a lot of detail to begin with. If I want, I can actually go ahead, apply levels on top and auto it. So basically this is the file which is completely auto levelized. If you don't really want it to change colors or such, so this is not definitely recommended. So I'll just take this. I'll go into Nuke and start compositing everything. So I'll just save out the file. So this was the older one, so I'll just go, let's say I call it, I'll save it as a TIFF without any layers, so it's a complete merged file. So once this is done, I'll switch over to Nuke. So within Nuke now, to open my PF track file, I'll just go into import script and just browse to where I've saved. So here I have my export PY file. I'll just go ahead and open this. So I have my entire PF track file opened up in here. So if I just connect this to the viewer, the only problem is this footage doesn't come in directly. So I'll just go ahead and open this footage. So now I actually have this. So as you can see, there is something happening, but there's this huge black box which is being created. If I switch over to my 3D view and turn around, you can see that it's actually the 3D mesh which came in. So this is the one which has come in from PF track. If I don't really want this mesh, I can import the mesh which I have from Maya. So I'll just go ahead to the tracker object here at the bottom. I'll just go ahead and import the object which I just exported. So I have my terrain 3 object. I'll just open that in. So as you can see, immediately the object has changed. The points stay the same, but the entire object is the new one. Next thing I can do is apply the image which I have for the shading of this terrain. So let me open that. So I'll just open that in. So as you can see, this is a file which has come in. So this is going to be the texture which I have to apply. So I'll connect it into my image and look at the final output. So this is what it looks like for now. The main things which I have to take care of include adding in only the required number of the basic channels, whatever I need to shade them properly. So let me go ahead and start the shading part. I'll just pause the video for some time and show you exactly what I've done. So there was a error over here in the file because of the overlapping, so I really couldn't continue. So I went ahead and actually redid the file just a little bit so it could be better. The mapping has changed and also the object, so let me go ahead and import the object too. I'll just go back into Maya and re-export the object also. has the same terrain 3 object, export selection, yes, and back into Nuke. I'll go into the object and where's the reload? Okay, so basically I reloaded the object. So as you can see, this is what I've got. Obviously, the blacking whatever is there is because of these things which I have here in the file. So whatever I had removed previously no longer works, so I'll have to go ahead and redo it once more. So here within Nuke, I just have these colors, single color applied. I have a shuffle node which is basically taking in all the red green red channels and converting it to black and white. So this is one shading option I have. And apart from this, if I just change it to green, you can see this is another shading option I have. And similarly, if I change it to blue, you can see this is yet more another shading option which I have. So I'm just going to start combining them together using these options to see exactly what kind of a result I can get. So first, this is my blue channel. I'll keep it aside. I'll create another shuffle node. And this one is going to have, let's say, green. And the last one here is going to have red. So I have red, green and blue coming in. I just don't want any alpha, so all of them have the white on the alpha there. So these are the three color values I have. I'm going to start merging them in and adding them on the object. So let me go ahead and merge red and green first. And then I'll merge red and blue. So this is going to give me the final result. So how I'm going to merge them is basically by using screen, and also just to get more control on this, I'll take a simple constant, a black constant, and merge it on top of this. And this is again going to be screen. So this is going to be reversed. So I'm just reversing the comp now. So now basically I have these three merge nodes. If I go to the first screen and change the merge option, you can see that affects one lighting situation. Similarly, if I go to the second merge and change that, it affects the second lighting situation. And similarly, the last one affects the third lighting situation. So I'm going to start editing these. I'll just keep them at zero first to try and match up my footage exactly. Okay, so I've just went ahead and edited it a little bit more to get more control. You can just see what I have done here to, and you can just replicate the same. Now, to begin with, I'm going to go ahead and remove the mix amount on all of these three merges. Let me remove everything and just make sure only these three are available. Now, first thing is this merge 3, which is at the bottom, is going to affect the actual key lighting which I have. So I'll just go put another viewer into the scene, and this viewer is going to be connected to the final 3D render which I have. Also, another thing which I had to do here is apply a remove. I just want all the alpha channel removed. I'm not doing this exactly in the shuffle node or the blend node, because I might add a gray node or anything extra on top of this. So anyway, I have this. I can come over here and I can start affecting this and see exactly how much of it I would need. So I guess that much is enough on that. So I have some amount of lighting which is done. Now I actually want to go ahead and apply the texture itself. So to apply the texture, what I have to do is import the tiled image which I had created. So let me go ahead and import that. So I have this rock repeat 2 imp. I'll import that one in. Now how I'm going to use this texture is I'm going to multiply that on top of this scene. So before that, I want this texture to be the right format. So let me go ahead, reformat this. And this is going to be 2K. So this is going to give me this results, and I don't want it to be stretched out. So let me go ahead and tell it to fill, or let's say fit. Okay, so distort is going to basically stretch it, and I don't really mind that right now. So I'll just put it in like that, and later on I'll apply a tile node on top. And after this tile, I'm going to merge it on top of this. So how exactly this is going to be merged equals this image which I'm getting in from here, the lighting information is the actual background, and the tile texture which I have is the actual foreground, and this is going to be actually multiplied on top. So this is what I'm going to get over here. But as you can see, this image is actually quite too, let's just say, too big. The details are too big. I actually want the details to be smaller. So to get the smaller details, I can go ahead and in the tile start multiplying these values. So let's say I scale it up to 3, and immediately you can start seeing that it is quite close by, but it's a bit too big yet. So okay, 2 tiling is looks sufficient. It looks good enough. So now I'll go back to my mergers and just edit it once more. So I'll just go back to these mergers which I had till I get it to match up as close as possible to the original output. Okay, I guess that itself is fitting in as best as possible there. One more thing you can actually try is after your shuffle node, you can apply a grade node, which is going to take the multiply value greater to a greater level, so you can actually get in more values than what is possible. So that's what I'm doing right now. I'm just taking in the key lights value to a greater level. So okay, this is done. As you can see, the rock actually matches up. So once I actually have this kind of a lighting situation underway, what I'll do is, if you remember these shuffle nodes, this is what is actually lighting the inside region. So I actually want to make it darker. I can go ahead and hit these. I'll go ahead and do that. Okay, a little bit is done. Also, one more thing I can do is render out the ambient occlusion from Maya itself, which is going to add in more details. So I'm satisfied with whatever I have right now. So let me go ahead and add in the viewer there. I'll go ahead and close this pane. So this is what I have. Next, what I want is an actual mask which is going to go around this entire region. So to create that mask, I'm going to reuse a 3D scene with the entire animation and all of it. So what I can do is basically go ahead and copy the entire thing, whatever I have here. I'll copy this and paste it, let's say, here on the side. So this is basically going to create my mat, this entire comp. So over here, what I'll do is, on this I'm going to apply a constant first. So this constant is going to come in from here, and it's going to be a 2K constant, the same as all other textures. So with this, I can actually, just to show you, I'll just take a checkerboard and apply this. So this is what it's going to do. It's actually going to go ahead and add in such details. So what I want to do is actually roto in details so that I can actually control how much of this mat is actually being used. So now once my constant is applied, I can go ahead and use one of these nodes which I have as reference for roto. I'll apply a roto paint node on top. I'll look through this and apply a roto paint node here. So this is what I'm getting. So as you can see, green is what is actually on the inside, and most of whatever is red is what is on the outside. So I can actually go ahead and start rotoing this. Obviously this is not the best way to get it done, but this is one way. So I'll just go ahead, take in my roto node, and start making out a mask. So whatever I have created right now, I'll go ahead and tell I want the, I don't really want the alpha from the roto node, so I'll get rid of that. And if I look at this at my final output, you'll see this is what I'm getting. It's creating this entire mat for me. So this black and white mat is what I'm going to use to create the final output. So let me go ahead and again split my view and keep another viewer here. So this is going to show me exactly what's happening, and here I can go ahead and roto whatever I want. So I'll go ahead, take my viewer, I'll disconnect it there and connect it here. So now I can go ahead and see exactly which part of the image is where. So this is one edge. So I want as less nodes as possible to actually control this region. So I'll just cusp this edge here and have this smoothed out and have this smooth one out there. Okay, so I have this one. I can go ahead and edit it how much ever I want. So let me go ahead and keep it as such. I'll edit it later. So this is one roto mask which is done. I'll add another one to this. So same as previous, I just want one node to control what is actually happening. So as soon as it's connected, you can see exactly what it's doing and where it is taking effect. So let me see where this is. Okay, so this is the region I actually want to edit. Okay, so there are too many nodes. Let me go ahead and delete a few of these. Okay, so I got this one done. Next is the top portion of it. So this one I'm going to start editing with another roto tool, and it's going to give me this. I'm going to edit it so I know exactly what's happening. Okay. Okay, so as you can see, everything is connected here. Now next step is this image which is coming in has a very random resolution of 640x480. Sorry, that's a proxy. It has 1967x1107. So I'm going to replace this by a constant black node. So let me go ahead and take a constant. And because this footage is already loaded, if I open up, it should... Okay, so it's already populated. I'll open that up and replace the footage. So it's going to give me just this black and white color inside. Now, let me just label these so you understand what's happening. I'll remove that. So this entire thing is basically creating this mat. So I'll just go ahead and add a backdrop node to this and call it mat. So this mat, the result of this mat is in the red node here at the bottom. Let me just make it green so it's easier to understand which one that is. Okay, so this final node which I have is the one I'm going to use for masking. What I'm going to mask is, I'm just going to take a merge node. This output which I'm getting from here, let me remove all these. This output which I'm getting from here, I want only this portion of this output. So what I'm going to do is take this as my actual foreground and actually have my background, which is this actual node without any of this thing happening. It's the actual clean background. So I'm going to use this as my background. So I want both of these on top of each other. So this is what is happening, but I only want this one cut out as this. So this is actually going to work as my mask. So I'm going to just take the mask input and connect it here. And immediately there is nothing happening because there is no alpha coming in from this. So I'll just come out into this and I'll tell I want it not to use alpha, but let's say red, for example. And immediately you can see it's cutting out exactly whatever it's cutting out here. So this is what I have. So now I can actually go ahead and start editing the roto to see exactly how much of this output I get, how I get it, and however I want it. So let me go ahead and reconnect my map here, and I'll open up the roto pane. So exactly I have this, and next I'll change my viewer from there to this, so I know exactly what's happening here when I change any output here. So first I know that this region is what I have to edit first, with this is the region I have here. So let me go ahead and start editing that. So I'm just editing it so that it's maintaining the background there, and I'm just going to cut it in a little bit. Okay, so once I have this much, what I can actually do is go ahead and use the feathering option on these to feather these so it actually blends in. So as you can see, it's blending in and it's really hard to know exactly where it's going on, but because of the blending it's also a little bit blurred out. I'll show you how we can create another mat to edit only this region in a few minutes. So next I want to edit the top portion. So the top happens to be this. Let me go ahead and see this. Okay, so this region has to be edited. It has to be feathered. So let me feather that. Okay, that is done. Next I want this region, so this would be here. Obviously if you have done a real good unwrapping where all these edges are together, you can have a much better output. So let me smooth that region out, take this in, smooth there. So I don't want these to overlap onto other rotos. So I have that there. Okay, and here I have a very sharp edge. Let's see where that is. Okay, at the same time I have it here. As if you observe here, you can see that there is a seam created here at the edge. Really can't help when such things happen because of the way it has been unwrapped. So obviously if it is at a lower resolution, it can't be made out. So it's, anyway, I'll leave it as it is for now. So this is one step of merging it in. Next step is actually trying to create the background elements a little bit so it can actually go on top of it. So for that, let me just see the end of this. Okay. Okay, one thing I'm observing is that this red matte which actually increased is not helping much. I'll just decrease that. Okay, I'll have to grade it once more. So anyway, I'll leave it as it is. Next, I'm going to go ahead and start editing this repeated texture which I have. So this texture is actually what is going to give me this region over here at the bottom. So because I already have these roto masks over here, I'm going to reuse similar things over here. So I'll just go ahead, copy this. So wherever I am using those references, I'm going to use it exactly there. Next, I'm going to apply a grade node here after the tiling, not before the tiling itself. So in this grade node, I'll just change something. And let me bring back the viewer from there. So as you can see, this is affected a lot. Now, what I'm going to do is apply or take a roto node to this. I'll take a roto node to this and I'll actually start editing it using this as reference. So first, to start with, I'll go ahead and take my roto brush and just draw in something, and this is going to be my actual mask. So let me take this and apply it as mask, and you can see exactly what it's doing. So let me go ahead and apply it back to the grain. So you can see what happens when I start moving it around. So I'm going to start by choosing this region, which is supposed to have this sandy outlook. So I'm going to delete this node, so I have that smoother region there. So let me actually go ahead and change this to this view so I can see exactly what's happening. Okay, so I have something which is going on like this. I'm going to use the grade node to actually grade it so that it is similar to whatever we have outside. So back to the grade node, I'm going to reset this. And I'm going to first start by increasing the multiply value. And going into the color, I'm going to increase the saturation of this and start changing the hue to a brownish one till I match up what we have here on the outside. And let me change the saturation. Okay, so I have something which looks similar. If I really want to match it, I can clamp the gamma and start editing it. So I'm just taking down the white point a bit. Okay. It has to look similar, so that is what I'm doing. Okay, next in the color, saturation. So once it's done, if I come out, it looks almost the same. So this is what the grade node is actually doing. If I disable and enable it, you can see the result. So it's actually just extending what we have there. So let me go ahead and edit it. So it is smoother on the inside. So I'll just go ahead and just go to the shape and start feathering it. Okay, so I have a little bit of feathering which is helping out. So with that, I'll go ahead and start editing the top roto over here. So let me just go ahead and just create a random roto. So 3 points minimum. Okay, so this is where I need it. I'll just keep it here. And next, what I can do is I can start reducing its color so it starts matching in to what it has to do. Obviously there is a seam, so it cannot match in 100%, so can't really do much about it. So apart from that, I have to match in the bottom portion here. So let me go ahead and start editing this. I'll just add in a random roto, 3 points. So that is done. The only reason I'm actually adding this is so that the border can be hidden a little bit. I don't really care about getting it exact. So that roto is done. Actually, I don't think it's that well. Let me go ahead and edit this part here because I don't really like that. Okay, so it just matches in better. Okay, another thing I can do is apply a grade right here and take down the white. Oops. Oops. Okay, so let's say I have this and I actually want to grade it properly now. So once before it actually goes into the final comp. Right here I can apply a new grade and start editing this till it matches perfectly. So to see whether or not this matches perfectly, obviously try to use your gamma clamps. So let me go ahead and increase this. Okay, that is being applied there. Let me delete that. I have to apply a grade here. I look at this through the viewer while I clamp these. So as you can see, most of the nodes on the outside and inside are similar, but the edges are not the same. So now if I use a grade node, I can actually start matching them in. Okay, at the same time, this node has to increase. So it's matching up with the lighting. And then again, I'll go clamp it on the reverse. So you can see this region here actually has black clamping very quickly, whereas here it's taking a very long time. So I actually want the black to clamp quite quick. So back into the grade. Just increased it a little bit. Okay, done. So now if I get rid of this grade, and remove this gamma clamp, this is what I have. Obviously, I don't need the black to be clamped that much. Okay, so this is what I have now. As you can see, it does match up quite a bit, not that exact, but still. Let me increase multiplier to match it better. Okay, done. So now if you want, you can go apply any kind of color correction or whatever you want on top of this. You can set up any particular look you want and create the final. Only thing I'm going to create is just edit this so a bit of the sand is actually going in. Okay, I think I like this look better, so Okay, similarly here. Let me just go ahead, do this, and I'll get. Okay, so I basically edited it, and this is what you have now. So from the beginning, we have this simple node, which is actually going ahead and creating this huge cavity within the rock. And now you can go ahead and add any kind of film look or whatever you want. So let me just create a simple grade node and add in something simple. Okay, so basically now I've just gone ahead, edited it, added in a couple of grade and color correction, and in the end I basically have this. So because it is tracked, the object stays in the same place. Because all these are actually rotored in, they're going to stay in the same place and not get edited by mistake or such. So basically I have this. Okay, so there are these few errors here. Let me go ahead and edit those. Okay, so I've edited all these now, and now finally if you want, you can go ahead and do this marker removal by just tracking them in and getting rid of them. Anyway, this is for the final. So let me go ahead and take a flipbook of this and show you the final output. So again, there are a few problems in the cycle which I just took. So as you can see here, there is a greenish tinge over here on the wall because of the algae, and even here on the right side, which is not being replicated, and also the rock here is not exactly the same color as the rock on this side. So I'm going to add a new grade node to first replicate this greenish tinge, and then another one to get rid of these white spots on the rock, so it adds in more realism. So let's go in here once more. I'm going to go take this rotor paint node. And with this open, let me go ahead and, because this is this one, I'm going to go ahead and create, okay, let me delete that stroke. So with this added into the mask, let me change something to see exactly where it's doing what. Okay, so this is the region I'm getting in. I'm going to go ahead and edit this. I don't want it on any of the corners, I just want it here on the edge. Okay, so I'm taking it as top as possible, and then I'm going to start blurring this. So I just thought I would create a concave detail here. Okay, so I have this. Now I'm going to actually start editing this detail, add in more greenish tinge into it. So let me undo that. And what I'll do is I'll just go into multiply. I'll first just take the color chooser, color picker, and choose a color here, this greenish tinge. And once I have that color, I can go into the color slider and actually take the saturation down and increase the value till I get the output which I look I'm looking for. So okay, got it there. But I guess I just made it a bit too much. So I'm just editing it so that it's going to towards the inside, and it actually matches in with the details on the outside. Next, as I can see, most of the details on the outside don't really have these bright white spots on them. So let me go look at this. I'll actually add a simple color correct node on top. And with this color correct, I'm going to take the highlights and gain them down. Okay, I guess the midtones. Okay. Okay, I'll just decrease the contrast instead to get it. So it's matching up better. Okay, now similarly, I've added this tinge over here. Let me go back to that. It doesn't seem to be working now. Okay, I just need to increase the saturation on this and change it to green. Okay, I got the similar tinge there, and now next step is going to be editing the lighting just a little bit, because without this, with that light, it really looks like as if the hole doesn't actually exist. It can't be seen like it's going inside. So I'll just go edit these and see which one will look better. So as you can see, this one is giving me a lot of details on the edges, so I really want that. So I'll keep this. Okay, so this rock here really is looking very interesting right now. So similarly, if I just look at what's happening here, so this one's adding a lot of light on the inside. So with this, I can see that this is the actual lighting which is happening on the top, whereas without it, if I increase this, it creates the entire thing, it's flat lit. And the last one gives me lighting on this side of the entire image. So I actually want both this and that. So what I'll actually do now is I'll go ahead and merge this separately and this one with a roto on top, so that I'm getting only this portion perfectly. So let me go ahead and increase this. So I had paused the recording till I finished this completely. So this happens to be the final script I have. Basically, I'm going on and taking the color passes for the light and adding it in to create the 3D shading on the flat object. And then using a mask which I've created. So using a mask I've created here, using another 3D node and combining it to create the output. So the output I have right now resembles this. So I just added in a bit of color corrections and such to get this. So as you can see, this is what I have. I'll just go ahead and add the final footage and play it through once. So now I've loaded in the footage, as you can see. So here there's a very simple composite, basic stuff. We just took a 3D mesh, added in some textures on top of it and composited it completely within Nuke. So as you can see, this can really produce some really high quality output without a lot of mistakes. Obviously I can add in some color corrections here at the bottom because it doesn't really match the entire scene at the ending. But really I'm satisfied with what I've created right now for this demo. So I really hope you understood what I did and found it useful. I'll see you next time.